Recorded Books presents Tired Teens, Understanding and Conquering Chronic Fatigue and POTS by Philip R. Fischer, M.D. Narrated by Adam Grupper. Welcome, readers. I, my family, thousands of tired teenagers, and this book have grown up together. Personally, I was down with chronic post-infectious fatigue when my third child was born 3 decades ago. I was recovering when my fourth child was born. That fourth child did a high school science project about postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, also known as POTS, several years ago, and then became the father of a daughter on the same day that the proof copy of this book was delivered to me. Through generations, children grow through adolescence into adulthood, sometimes with debilitating fatigue along the way. Yet there is always hope of recovery and of new birth. From my personal and professional experiences, this book has been born and is now delivered to you. I offer this book with the hope that it will encourage and inspire you as you face chronic fatigue in yourself or in someone about whom you care deeply. I give you these words in expectation that you too will find healing and recovery. I am eager to see and hear about how your recoveries will allow you to grow and serve others. May this book help overcome illness, restore health, provide hope, and generate life-enhancing productivity. Share your stories and ideas with me at tiredteenagers@gmail.com. Enjoy. Dr. Phil Fischer. Preface. Teenagers are tired. In near epidemic proportions, adolescents today are struggling with fatigue. Teenagers know this. Many hit the snooze button and delay getting out of bed for as long as possible in the morning. They're still dragging when they get to school, and they use caffeinated drinks to help them get through the morning. Parents know teens are tired. They struggle to encourage their kids to get up and get ready for school, but they feel like they're nagging. Then, long after their own bedtime, parents try to convince their teenagers to go to bed so parents won't be so tired in the morning. Schools know teenagers are tired. Some have even tried shifting to a later morning start time. Teachers recognize that adolescent academic performance improves mid-morning. And doctors know teenagers are tired. Research suggests that close to a third of American adolescent girls struggle with morning fatigue more than once a week. In Europe, about 20% of Dutch girls and 7% of Dutch boys struggle with tiredness that has persisted for more than 3 months. In England, more than 1 out of every 100 adolescents is disabled with fatigue and unable to participate in regular school and social activities. Fatigue is common, and it messes up lives. All over the world, teenagers and their families struggle with fatigue. Unfortunately, neither the teenagers nor the parents understand why teens are so tired, and their doctors have struggled unsuccessfully to give them clear answers. Why are so many teenagers tired? Is there an underlying mystery diagnosis robbing adolescents of energy? How can they recover? You see, I'm a pediatrician, and I care for patients who travel up to thousands of miles to find answers and to begin recovery. Many of my patients are tired, and they haven't even started getting better, despite even years of good motivation and dedicated effort by themselves, by their families, and by their doctors. Most of the people we see end up finding answers, hope, and healing. This is good. But the word has spread. Hundreds of families want to come see the team with which I work. But we can't grow our staff fast enough to see all the people who want to come for help. So I'm writing this audiobook as a personal message to you, whether you're a tired teen or the loved one of a tired teen. My goal is to help you find direction in your quest for recovery. My goal is to provide you with answers and with the tools to help you actually get better. I'd love to meet you and to work with you personally, but I'd love it even more if you could recover without needing to see us. Even though this audiobook is intended as a personal communication with you, it has taken a huge team to allow me to provide these pages. I had lots of great teachers over the years, and I've learned even more from patients and families since completing my pediatric training in 1984. Great colleagues have participated in this journey to understand chronic fatigue in adolescence. We don't have all the answers yet, but science has advanced enough to provide lots of help. It's taken time and the help of many people to bring this audiobook to you. Still, recovery won't come simply by listening to this audiobook or even by implementing the suggestions on these pages. You'll need your own team to foster recovery. Your team will include supportive family and friends, caring health professionals, and a whole host of other people. I hope that the words of this audiobook will provide enough information and even inspiration to help you get started down a successful road to recovery. It's miserable to feel tired. Many other teens are struggling with fatigue also. You'll get through this difficult journey. The tiredness and misery aren't permanent. What this audiobook is about. This audiobook is about tired teenagers. It's about why they're tired and how they can recover. What can you anticipate as you listen? The first two sections deal with persistent fatigue in general and can help you understand why you feel tired and what you can do about it. The third and fourth sections are dedicated specifically to teens whose chronic fatigue is part of a condition known as postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, also known as POTS. POTS accounts for more than half of the disabling fatigue in teens. Who this audiobook is for? So, who might benefit from this audiobook? You, if you're an adolescent bothered by long-term fatigue. You, if you have a family member or friend suffering from bothersome tiredness. You, if you provide care to tired teenagers. Sometimes, comments are mostly directed to teens, and at other times, comments are useful mostly for friends and relatives of tired teens. But we all benefit together as we share information. My hope is that every listener will find value in this audiobook, and that ultimately these pages will help tired teens and their families make progress to real recovery. We're in this together. I'll share my years of experience treating teens with fatigue, while one of my former patients, Laura, and her parents will discuss the more personal side of living with POTS and chronic fatigue. Later, I'll share insights from some of our nurses, Jeannie and Kay, too. Now, though, let's hear from Laura. Laura. I led a normal, healthy life growing up. As a competitive swimmer and violinist, I was always on the go. A normal day for me involved rushing from a full day at school to a 3-hour swim practice, followed by a violin lesson, dinner, homework, and sleep. I loved being busy and doing the things I enjoyed. So when I got sick at the age of 15, it was devastating. At first, I simply felt sluggish in the water, not performing to my level of ability. Then other symptoms started to arise: a racing heart rate, chronic headaches, nausea, and extreme fatigue. Over a period of 3 months, I went from training 3 to 6 hours a day to barely being able to walk up a flight of stairs. I could not drag myself out of bed in the morning and would sleep the whole day away. I was unrecognizable from the lively, active teenager I had been just months before. My family and I went from doctor to doctor trying to find an answer for what was happening to me. No matter how many tests were run, no one could seem to find a concrete diagnosis, and I became increasingly frustrated as I watched life go by from my bed. Laura's parents. In retrospect, many of the early signs were evident that would have indicated that Laura was beginning to struggle with POTS. The problem was that we had no idea what was happening. Laura had been a competitive swimmer for years. During the summer between her freshman and sophomore years of high school, she was participating in swim team practices twice a day. While her teammates were going to movies, working, or hanging out between practice sessions, our daughter was sleeping. She would complain of her feet and legs feeling so heavy. Despite the twice-a-day practices and her long periods of rest, her racing swim times got slower and slower. She looked very pale, and her energy level was best described as sluggish. She was just 15 years old. As parents, we just thought she was training too hard and likely growing, which was putting a significant amount of stress on her body. So it seemed understandable that she might need more sleep. The first specialist we saw felt her issues were due to overtraining. The treatment was to stop swimming for a month, rest, and focus on nutrition. In the fall of her junior year, she continued to slide further and further until the fatigue kept her from attending school regularly. All the while, we were going from doctor to doctor to determine the cause of her ever-increasing number of symptoms. All the test results were coming back as normal, but the symptoms persisted. It took a while for our daughter to develop the dizziness, tachycardia, rapid heart rate, and severe brain fog. Once she stopped swimming and was spending the majority of her time sleeping, she became more and more deconditioned, and the symptoms came on full force. Unfortunately, the symptoms were coming fast and furious, but the test results never changed. They remained normal. We still did not have a diagnosis. Our now 16-year-old daughter was sleeping about 20 hours a day, and she was miserable. Our happy-go-lucky, sweet, and energetic daughter was gone, and we began to fear that she might not get better. Her life looked nothing like it did 1 year before. Simple tasks like getting out of bed, showering, and getting dressed were major hurdles. She was spinning out of control, and we were beyond worried and very frightened. Without a diagnosis, we were losing hope and frustrated, as no one could help us understand what was happening. So, you've met me, and now you've met Laura and her parents. Along the way, you'll hear more from all of us. And you'll also get to read comments from Jeannie and Kay, great nurses who have helped hundreds of teenagers overcome POTS and other forms of chronic fatigue. Ultimately, I look forward to hearing stories of your full and complete recovery from fatigue. You can write to me at tiredteenagers@gmail.com. Misery and hope. Tiredness and recovery. There is potential that each of you and the people for whom you care can be accurately diagnosed and that you can actually get better. Recovery? Yes. Full recovery is possible. Some important definitions. Before we move forward, let's make sure we're talking the same language. Let's review some definitions. These definitions will introduce some topics to frame ongoing discussions, and I'll talk about all of this in more detail later. Fatigue. Practically, we consider the terms fatigue and tiredness to mean the same thing. While sleepiness can be part of fatigue and tiredness, in this audiobook, we usually take fatigue and tiredness to mean more than just sleepiness, and to indicate a generalized sense of lacking energy. It can feel like a heaviness of both body and mind. It can feel like a burden that makes activity seem overwhelmingly difficult. Chronic. The word chronic means long-term. Usually, fatigue is considered to be chronic when it has persisted for 3 or more months. And chronic fatigue implies that the fatigue is almost always present, as opposed to intermittent fatigue, which comes and goes. Chronic fatigue can rise and fall in intensity, but it's usually felt almost all of the time. Syndrome. The term syndrome refers to a collection of symptoms or physical findings that fit together. For example, POTS is a syndrome associated with a set of specific symptoms that you'll learn about later. Autonomic nervous system. The involuntary, autonomic, nervous system regulates things we don't usually need to think about. It controls blood flow, intestinal flow, and temperature, among other things. Autonomic dysfunction. Sometimes the involuntary nervous system gets out of balance, and people have trouble with blood flow, dizziness, fatigue, intestinal flow, nausea, abdominal discomfort, or temperature regulation, feeling hotter or colder than peers, having sensations like hot flashes. We call this situation autonomic dysfunction, and some people use the similar term, dysautonomia. Autonomic dysfunction can be a problem in and of itself, or it can stem from a separate medical problem that reveals itself through the autonomic nervous system. Orthostatic intolerance. Some tired adolescents, like Laura, have extreme fatigue associated with an inability to exercise, as well as bothersome dizziness when standing up. These teenagers often also have headaches and abdominal discomfort. When someone feels worse standing up rather than lying down on a daily basis, we say that the person has orthostatic intolerance. Ortho refers to the upright position, and intolerance means, well, that the person doesn't tolerate the position very well. Postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, also known as POTS. POTS is a form of autonomic dysfunction characterized by long-term orthostatic intolerance and an excessive change in heart rate when switching to an upright position. Some people have just autonomic dysfunction with orthostatic intolerance, very similar to the symptoms of POTS. But people with POTS also have an excessive change in heart rate when they stand up. Some people, like Laura, notice that their hearts race when standing up, or their doctors notice this. The term postural relates to position change. The term orthostatic refers to being upright and still. And the term tachycardia means fast heart. The term syndrome indicates a collection of symptoms, such as long-term fatigue, daily trouble being upright, excessive heart rate when standing up, and other symptoms like headache and abdominal discomfort. For simplicity, some people leave the word orthostatic out of the label and refer to the condition as postural tachycardia syndrome. Chronic fatigue versus chronic fatigue syndrome. Sometimes chronic fatigue is also referred to as a syndrome. When I use the term chronic fatigue in this audiobook, I'm referring to a long-term experience of tiredness and lack of energy. People who have chronic fatigue often have lots of other symptoms, and these other symptoms sometimes make up a specific cluster that's shared by other people. Since the 1990s, researchers have lumped several symptoms and findings together into what's called chronic fatigue syndrome. This sort of clustering can be useful in research studies to make sure that study participants are actually similar and comparable. But in common usage, the term chronic fatigue syndrome has sometimes come to mean a tiredness associated with lots of other problems that aren't well understood and from which you might never recover. So I don't like to use the chronic fatigue syndrome label outside of research settings, since it ends up discouraging patients and their families unnecessarily. As you will see in this audiobook, we actually do understand a lot about chronic fatigue, and most people do get better. Laura's parents. A few months after Laura's 16th birthday, we made our way to the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota, where we finally determined what was happening. Finally, a diagnosis. We were very relieved to have a treatment plan and were hopeful that Laura's recovery journey would begin. Ready? We've set the stage. We've connected with Laura and her parents. We understand some important terms. We want to overcome chronic fatigue. Now let's get moving. Section 1. Chronic Fatigue. Chapter 1. Got sleep? It takes effort to enjoy winter in Minnesota. It's dark when I go to work, and it's dark again before I head home. The air is frigidly cold, and walkways are icy. In Southern California, where I grew up, the weather almost always seemed perfect. After 22 Minnesota winters, though, I feel a bit sorry for people stuck in California. They miss out on seasons. Californians don't get to enjoy lawns covered with fall leaves and the springtime return of migrating birds. Our world was created with rhythms and patterns. The seasons change. The sun rises and sets. The rhythms of human life, such as our music and our sports, in many ways reflect the changing cycles of the natural world. We prefer rhythms to monotone music, and we like both pauses and crescendos. Our sports contests have quarters and innings and periods, and each sport has its season. We move from one phase of activity to the next. Our bodies, too, were designed to follow rhythms. Our body chemistry and our hormones follow cycling patterns. We rest and rejuvenate at night, and we actively deplete our stored resources during the day. We cycle between activity and rest, from times of energy expenditure to periods of recovery. Except when we're busy. Sometimes feeling tired all day is simply a matter of not getting enough sleep. We may think that what we're doing is so important, or we allow our lives to get so busy that we don't have time to slow down and let our bodies go through the rest cycles for which they were designed. Sleep needs. A while ago, a young teen came from a few states away to see me because she was tired all the time. After a thorough evaluation, I realized that her only problem was that she wasn't getting enough sleep. I explained that the average adolescent needs about 9 hours of sleep each night, and that her 6 hours simply weren't enough. Her mother stiffened up, raised her voice, and exclaimed that, "You don't understand teenagers in Texas. She's too busy to get more than 6 hours of sleep each night." Clearly, this mother and daughter had unrealistic expectations about what a body can do and how much sleep is actually necessary. In the United States, high schoolers get an average of 7.5 hours of sleep each night. Sure, some bodies are set up to do fine with this, but others need more than the average 9 hours per night. Insufficient sleep contributes to lots of fatigue. While each person is an individual, most adolescents need 9 hours of good sleep each night. What makes us think we're too busy to sleep? For some teens, high-achieving gymnasts and dancers, for example, there's this notion that you need to practice a sport for 4 to 6 hours per day and excel at schoolwork and spend lots of time with friends. Adolescent bodies are rarely prepared to perform at professional levels while maintaining other normal teen life activities. Other teenagers have become possessed by their possessions. One of the hardest struggles for people when dealing with a severe storm is to go without electricity. They have no way to charge their phones and other devices. Similarly, technology tools that were designed to help us can end up enslaving us. We begin to think that we need to be turned on and logged in and responding to others 24 hours a day. For years, we have known that watching too much television leads to obesity and fatigue. Wise pediatric leaders suggest that adolescents spend no more than 2 hours per day watching screens, television, videos, movies, social media, non-educational internet sites. Nonetheless, most teenagers spend at least twice that much time each day in front of a screen. Do you sleep with your cell phone in your hand? It could be that you and your phone are not allowing your body to relax enough to get into the good deep sleep stages. Sometimes we get too busy doing things that seem normal, even though they work against our physical and mental health. Lots of things can make us think we're too busy to get enough sleep. whether sports or schoolwork or just hanging with friends. Each of us needs to set priorities. Once we're out of balance and getting tired, though, we start doing things less comfortably and less effectively. That's when it might be appropriate to do a time inventory and clean up our schedule so that we're balancing important things with adequate time to relax and sleep. We need breaks and changes of scenery during the day. Perhaps that should include some technology fasts where we go without direct connection with our communication devices. Are you getting enough sleep? If you use an alarm to wake up, your body is probably not adequately rested. If you sleep longer on weekends than during the week, then your body is probably trying to pay back the sleep debt that accumulated during the week. Either way, you probably need more sleep. Laura. No amount of sleep seemed to alleviate my overwhelming fatigue. I frequently slept the day away and would start feeling more awake by the late afternoon and into the evening. When it was actually time for me to go to bed for the night, I would feel wide awake, even though I was extremely fatigued. My sleep hygiene at this time was dismal. I would watch TV in bed when I could not fall asleep, and always had my phone right next to me throughout the night. Sleep and the rhythms of life. How does sleep work, anyway? In Alaska, where I hid to finish writing this audiobook, bears shut down for the winter. They put their bodies into slow motion as a means of surviving until more food becomes available. Humans don't hibernate. We don't really shut down at night. Instead, we keep burning energy, about 90 to 95% of our daytime level of energy consumption. Instead of turning off, our brains cycle through a series of sleep stages. Our hormone levels go up and down. Our muscles relax. Our circulation clears excess waste from our systems. Our bodies rejuvenate and grow. Human sleep isn't simply like the inactivity of a hibernating bear. Rather, sleep is a programmed series of restorative events. Studies of human brain waves identify several different stages of sleep. When you drift off to sleep, your brain gradually shifts into progressively deeper phases of sleep, called non-rapid eye movement, also known as NREM, sleep. In the deepest phase of sleep, brain waves are large and slow, and you're more difficult to awaken. This is the most restorative phase of sleep. From deep sleep, you move into rapid eye movement, or REM, sleep, during which the eyes move and the body is relatively paralyzed. Dreams take place during the REM phase. For older teens and adults, the body cycles through NREM and then REM sleep about every 90 minutes. And later night sleep is richer in the REM component. Disruption of these cycles can lead to trouble during the day, including the inability to focus and perform mental tasks. Awakening is most effective when people wake up during light sleep, such as just after completing a whole sleep cycle, terminating with full REM sleep. Rather than waking up according to a time on a clock, some people are now buying alarm clocks that sense their sleep stage and awaken them during light sleep. Daytime napping sometimes provides an escape to help stave off some sleepiness, but it doesn't allow for bodily restoration like full nighttime sleep cycles do. And daytime napping makes it harder to initiate sleep at an appropriate time. A 2005 report in the medical journal Pediatrics suggested that 15 million American children were not getting enough sleep. Things haven't improved much since then, and the sleepless teenagers in that study had more health problems and less family harmony at home than did those teens who got enough sleep. American children and adolescents need more sleep, and they need better sleep. Quick take. So what does all this mean? First, people will be most refreshed and least fatigued if they get enough sleep. For most teenagers, enough is about 9 hours each night. Second, sleep is most useful if it's allowed to cycle through all stages, and if awakening occurs after completing deeper sleep, followed by a complete REM stage. Waking up to an alarm clock, determined by a schedule, is less effective than timing day-night cycles to allow for spontaneous morning awakening. Third, naps are okay for emergencies, but frequent naps end up leading to lower quality and quantity of necessary nighttime sleep. Regulating sleep cycles. The daily cycle of wakefulness and sleep is called the circadian rhythm. One of the key physiologic factors regulating sleep is a chemical called melatonin. Melatonin is secreted during the evening from the pineal gland in the head. Melatonin helps to initiate sleep in the evening and maintain sleep through the night. We know that teenagers...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.